Muslim nations.
Of course, there is still much work to be done. That means honestly confronting the crisis of Islamic extremism and the Islamicists and Islamic terror of all kinds. We must stop what they're doing to inspire, because they do nothing to inspire but kill.
So speaking afterwards, a senior White House official said actually President Trump had been stronger rather in his message than what was anticipated, rather than toning down, he was being strong. Obviously his base, they want his base to support, if you will, to understand that this was a tough, strong message. He wasn't backing down on what he said he would do. Anna?
So the president's off to Israel tomorrow, Elise, and I understand you just learned about what could be a major development. Tell us about it.
Well, Anna, as the president heads towards Israel, today was Jerusalem Day, which is the Israeli celebration of its victory in the 1967 war and what they call the liberation of Jerusalem. And who was there? None other than the U.S. Ambassador to Israel, David Friedman, who just took up his post. Now, this is a controversial attendance by Ambassador Friedman. This is the first time any U.S. diplomat has ever attended these Jerusalem Day celebrations, where Benjamin Netanyahu is talking about Jerusalem being the unified capital under Israeli control that's not for negotiation. And this comes as President Trump is seeking to negotiate peace between the Israelis and the Palestinians. Jerusalem is a very sensitive, what they call a final status issue in that. And for Ambassador Friedman to be sitting at these celebrations, in effect, endorses the Israeli idea that Jerusalem could be that unified capital. Now, with President Trump facing all this controversy about what he's going to do with the embassy, a very controversial move that's certainly going to anger the Arab states, as President Trump gave this very, what he thought, positive message to them today.
Right, Elise Labed and Nick Robertson, our thanks to both of you for joining us. President Trump is thousands of miles away, but again, back here at home in Washington, the cloud of the Russia investigation still hangs over the White House. The Senate Intelligence Committee wants to see the White House notes that reportedly led to bombshell report in the New York Times. The report claimed during the president's meeting with Russian officials at the White House, President Trump referred to former FBI Director James Comey as a, quote, nut job, and said firing Comey eased great pressure on him. Here's what Senator Marco Rubio, a member of the Intelligence Committee, had to say this morning on State of the Union.
And those responses are based on notes that I haven't seen, and neither have you. I'm not denying that they're, I'm not admitting that they are. We don't know. And that's why we need to have an inquiry that looks at all of that. That's why I asked the White House to produce those notes to the Intelligence Committee so we could review it. And I thought that was important, and I continue to believe it's important for them to do.
Let's talk it over with California Congressman Ted Lieu, a Democrat. And Congressman, thanks for being with us. I want to first put up a tweet of yours last night. I am on the House Judiciary Committee. This is what I am going to read this evening. We see a photo of impeachment and removal research there. So your committee is where the impeachment process would begin. Clearly, you're starting some research, but can you go as far as to say that the impeachment process is officially underway?
Thank you, Honor, for your question. CNN broke the story that the White House lawyers were looking at impeachment proceedings. I sit on a House Judiciary Committee. I thought it would be prudent for me to do the same thing. And that's because the last 2 weeks have been a turning point. We've seen the president commit what looks like obstruction of justice in real time.
Now, you would need at least four Republicans, if I'm understanding it all correctly, and all the Democrats, to move the impeachment process out of your committee. Have any of your Republican colleagues signaled they're with you at this point?
They have not, but this is a fast-moving story. We know that 2 weeks ago, the president took an action of firing the FBI director. A few days later, he admitted on national TV that he did it because the Russian probe was on his mind. And then just last Friday, the New York Times reports an account that the White House does not dispute, which is the president did this to relieve great pressure on him. This is exactly what obstruction of justice looks like.
And yet, I spoke with respected constitutional lawyer Alan Dershowitz this week, and he argues the opposite. He says there's no case of obstruction against Trump. Watch.
The president is the head of the executive branch, a unitary executive branch.
constitutionally, he can control the branch. He could tell the director of the FBI, do not prosecute Flynn. He can say, prosecute so-and-so. There is no constitutional barrier to the president doing that. But the president has a constitutional right now to pardon Flynn and to pardon everybody in the Russian investigation and say there will be no more investigations.
Congressman Alan Dershowitz says he voted for Hillary Clinton. It's not like he has been a longtime Trump supporter or anything. So what's your response to what we just heard?
Alan Dershowitz is wrong, and a smarter person, Lawrence Tribe, disagrees with him. And I disagree with Alan because Congress has a full right to review the actions. We get to decide what constitutes a high crime. And if the president commits obstruction of justice, that could certainly fit what constitutes a high crime.
Remember, impeachment against Bill Clinton was a political disaster for Republicans back in the 90s. Clinton's poll numbers went sky high as a lot of Americans thought, you know, there was a possible GOP vendetta against him. So, Congressman, do you worry by going down this path of impeachment, possibly, and just the idea of it that we're discussing here, might it have a similar effect on your Democratic Party, the opposite of what you would hope?
I think a better comparison would be Richard Nixon. The first article of impeachment for Richard Nixon was obstruction of justice. Impeding a federal investigation or obstructing it is a serious felony. Anybody else that commits obstruction of justice would face up to 5 years of prison time. This is very different than what President Clinton may or may not have done. But we do need to let the investigations run its course so we can review the full facts.
Do you worry about overruling the will of the American people because this president was elected?
Impeachment is one of the gravest decisions that Congress can make other than declaring war. It should never be our first option. That's why we need to review all the facts, have full and fair deliberations, and then make the decision based on the facts.
Now, I want to ask you about the president's trip overseas. This is his first trip abroad. A lot has been said about where he is choosing to take this trip. In Saudi Arabia first, he'll head to Israel tomorrow. I just want to get your take. How do you think he's doing so far representing the United States?
I sit on the House Foreign Affairs Committee. I'm an American. I want our president to represent us well. I want him to be strong. I want him to make us proud. And I'm not going to criticize the president for his foreign policy while he's on foreign soil.
Did he move the ball forward in a positive direction among the Arab community today in how he addressed terrorism?
I think it's a good thing that he did not use the words radical Islamic terrorism in a Muslim country. I think the president, when he comes back, needs to explain why he wants to ban Muslims from entering the United States. But we'll wait for the president to come back before we have that debate.
What would be your advice as he enters Israel and is working on the Palestinian and Israeli peace process?
That he needs to be fair and impartial. And again, that he needs to represent U.S. interests first, and I hope the president does well.
What are those U.S. interests that he needs to represent there?
That we need to ensure the safety and security of the United States, of Israel, and we need to make sure that we can have a two-state solution and be on a path to go to a two-state solution between Israel and the Palestinians.
All right, Congressman Ted Lieu, our thanks to you for joining us. Coming up, more challenges for President Trump on the world stage, differences with the Pope, with NATO allies, even some tensions with Israel developing. Plus, the First Lady's fashion choices getting a lot of attention in conservative Saudi Arabia. We'll tell you why. And the video going viral, a sea lion snatching a little girl from her family. We'll show you what happens next. President Trump's first official trip abroad really just begins. Tomorrow, he departs Saudi Arabia for Israel. Then he's there. He's in the West Bank. He'll go to the Vatican City, then Belgium, and back to Italy. He's going to be outside the country for an entire week. I want to get CNN contributor and former U.S. Ambassador Norman Eisen in here with us. Also, CNN political commentator and former White House political advisor Jeffrey Lord. Norman, to you first. Tomorrow in Israel, the president will face people he made promises to during the campaign. Promises like this one. Let's listen.
We will move the American embassy to the eternal capital of the Jewish people, Jerusalem.
Well, the president has since backed off that promise. How does this hurt the president's credibility in Israel?
Anna, thanks for having me. And if the president can get away with facing the Saudi and other Muslim leadership from across the Middle East after his outrageous and inflammatory anti-Muslim statements in the campaign, he'll be able to get away with the Israelis with not yet having moved the embassy to Jerusalem. The line that the White House gives on background is, not yet, we're considering, delay, procrastinate, and it's early in the relationship for them to take him to task. So he'll skate by this time.
Jeffrey, you know, promising to move the embassy was a pretty huge moment during the campaign. Why should the Israeli people believe the next promise he makes?
Well, I think he will do it at some point. I mean, he is a man of his word with these kind of things. I mean, we need to pull back here and see what's going on. Here is a man who is going not to Canada, to the comforts of Canada or Mexico in our own North American continent, but his first foreign trip, he is plunging right into the heart of the most difficult problem on this planet. He went straight to Riyadh, to Saudi Arabia. He goes from there to Jerusalem, which is unprecedented, and then he will go to Rome. And we're talking the three major faiths here in the world, and he is going to have a very candid conversation with all of these folks that they need to pull together, they need to help, we need to stop this insanity that's going on of people killing in the name of religion. I mean, this is barbaric. Absolutely.
I want to read
barbaric.
You some of the headlines in advance of the president's visit to Israel. Haven't been the best, got to say. Take a look at these. Analysis, six reasons Trump's visit appears to be jinxed. The Israeli right's love affair with Trump goes from ecstasy to agony. Jeffrey, what do you think these are about?
Well, I think that's normal human behavior. Let me, you know, as you know, I work for President Reagan, and I'm not a big Jimmy Carter fan. But let me say something for President Carter. President Carter was an outsider, not unlike Donald Trump. And the one lasting contribution that I think he made in world peace and in the Middle East was bringing the Israelis and the Egyptians together. I was a young member of congressional staff in 1978 and 79 when he was doing this, and I remember vividly the negative headlines that people thought this was simply not possible as he brought Prime Minister Begin and President Sadat from Egypt and just more or less locked them up in Camp David until they got it done. But he did get it done. You have to think outside the box, and you have to be willing to take this kind of skepticism and criticism. It comes with a turf, and Donald Trump is somebody who thinks big and believes in never giving up, and he thinks outside the box. So God bless him.
All right. I think everybody could agree it would be great if he was able to accomplish what no other president before him has been able to do when it comes to that conflict in the region. But meantime, he'll also move on and he'll meet with the Pope. There has been a little contentious back and forth between those two leading up to this. This is the moment that Trump sort of bashed the Pope during the campaign. Listen.
So the Mexican government fed the Pope a tremendous amount of stuff about Trump is not a good person. And the Pope just made a statement. Can you imagine? I just got a call. As I'm walking up here, they said, Mr. Trump, the Pope made a statement about you. I said, the Pope. What did the Pope say? I like the Pope. I mean, was it good or bad? Because if it's good, I like the Pope. If it's bad, I don't like the Pope. No, it's true.
He's having a little fun there, Norman. How do you see their meeting going?
Well, I hope the Pope speaks about the thing that the president failed to speak about in Saudi Arabia today, universal human rights, the dignity of all people. And I think the Pope will. The Pope is not afraid to tell the president. I was disappointed that he told the Saudis code words, we're not going to lecture you. I hope the Pope will tell him, Mr. President, your divisiveness, your separation, your harmful rhetoric, is not consistent with the values that make us great as human beings. So I'm looking for a little bit of papal instruction for the president.
Jeffrey, was that a missed opportunity for the president today not to address human rights issues?
No, I don't think so. This is his first time on the world stage here. And I think the big opportunity that he took was to do something that President Obama was utterly unable to do. And that is to bring together these three faiths and bring an end to Islamic terrorism. President Obama, for all the reasons that we know, more or less produced ISIS, but with his policies in Iraq.
Those are some pretty strong words. How so do you feel like President Obama introduced ISIS?
Well, he made it a point to get America as much as possible out of Iraq. That was one of his campaign promises.
ISIS emanated in Syria, though, in terms of the getting the facts. It wasn't Iraq. It was Syria.
Oh, they're clearly in Iraq. They're clearly all over the place in the Middle East. They want to have a caliphate. And President Obama's view of all this was, I'm not going to touch this. I'm not going to touch it. I mean, one good thing to speak up for him that he did do was go after Osama bin Laden, which was initiated in the Bush administration. And God bless him for doing that. But he had a worldview here that was basically Neville Chamberlain's. It was weakness and appeasement, and all that did was induce more war. So you've got to bring this to a close.
Remember, President Trump was touting on the campaign trail that he didn't think we should have gone into Iraq to begin with. Norm, I've seen you shaking your head. I'll give you a chance to respond.
What a bucket of nonsense, Jeffrey. ISIS was an offshoot of Al-Qaeda. The President Obama fought them tooth and nail. We can agree or disagree about different strategies, but that's foolishness. And I think what we should be looking at instead is President Trump today. There was a downside to his embrace of the Sunni world. He inflamed the Shiites. He essentially took sides in the Sunni-Shia battle. He contributed to the sectarianism in the region, Anna. So that's a troubling, and I think we should deal with that reality, not Jeffrey's fantasies about President Obama.
Your answer, Norman, is that we should invade the Middle East again.
No, Jeffrey. My answer is it's false that President Obama was responsible for the creation of ISIS. My answer is that we need to look at what President Trump is doing today. And among the failures in Riyadh, there were pluses. It's not entirely negative. But among the two blatant failures was he had political capital to raise human rights. That's what makes us Americans. We speak up for free speech.
Norman failed to do it.
Jeffrey, let me finish, please. He failed to do it, and that is a failure. And then he took sectarian sides. He did not sufficiently remain balanced in the sectarian battles of the Middle East. Those are two substantial failures that I think we need to focus on more than these outlandish and false claims about
Norman,
Obama.
Norman, quickly, all I'm saying is you did it your way, President Obama's way. It failed, and the American people want to go a different way.
All right, Jeffrey Lord, Ambassador Norman Eisen, thank you both. Coming up here in the newsroom, Melania Trump in her international debut, a look at the First Lady's agenda abroad and the advantage she may have over her predecessors. And frightening moments for a family when their little girl is snatched by a sea lion. First Lady Melania Trump's getting some rave reviews from the Saudi press for her fashion choices. The Desert Kingdom's major paper calling the First Lady classy, conservative, and elegantly respectful. I want to bring in CNN White House reporter and expert on all things First Ladies, Kate Bennett. Kate, thanks for being with us. The First Lady we saw in those photos and in those images, she chose not to wear a headscarf during this visit. Michelle Obama, Laura Bush also did not. Given that this is a country criticized for oppression of women, is she making a political or a social statement through her style?
I mean, I really don't think so. It wouldn't be like what we know about Melania Trump so far for her to make some big political statement or discuss policy. It's just sort of not what she said she's going to do. It's not what we've seen her do so far. I think like many other modern women from other countries, she's not wearing a headscarf simply because she wasn't asked to and she's not required to. And that's exactly what the White House said when I asked them why she wasn't wearing it. And other foreign leaders, female foreign leaders like Angela Merkel and Theresa May on recent visits have also not worn a headscarf. So it's not super unusual that she didn't do it. And I think it's certainly just a personal choice.
And the First Lady has not been one to want to call attention to herself. We know that so far on this trip, she's visited an elementary school. That was earlier today. She talked to some sixth graders, some other elementary school students. She also has visited a women's business service center there. What kind of role do you think she's carving for herself right now in foreign diplomacy based on what we've seen so far?
You know, I think Melania Trump has a few things going for her, and one of them is that there's sort of this inherent mystique about her. I call it the Melania mystique. We don't know that much about her. She's, for the most part, been relatively, private. She doesn't live in Washington or the White House full time. Her schedule isn't jam-packed with events. She's only given a handful of public speeches. So I think what she's really trying to do is sort of play her traditional role of a first lady, go to things like schools and hospitals and celebrate cultural events. I don't think she's looking to rock the boat right now. And really, she has a very humanizing effect within this Trump administration of just being, she's coming across as warm, as calm, peaceful, put together. And there's something about her that makes us curious, and I think that's going to help her in the long run as she establishes a more robust schedule.
She is the only first lady born outside the U.S. She was raised in Slovenia, lived in France and Italy. Does that give her an advantage abroad? She definitely seems comfortable.
That's right. I mean, remember years and years ago when Jackie Kennedy spoke French when she was on French soil, and like, I think there's a way that Melania Trump really can use her international background and that perspective. She should just be herself in that sense. And I'm sort of hoping as this trip moves on that she's able to do that. I think there's a global interest in her. She's an immigrant. She did come from Slovenia, a communist country. She's, worked her way through America and then, ultimately ended up married and first lady. So I think there's a way that she can certainly use her diverse background to relate to people around the world. And she should.
And she speaks five languages, including Italian. So maybe she'll be able to use that when they head to Rome. Kate Bennett, thank you very much.
Thank you.
Some frightening moments for some tourists in British Columbia. A young girl plucked from the pier, dragged underwater.
Oh my God!
More on the story here coming up. Welcome back. You're live in the CNN newsroom. We have some shocking video to show you. A sea lion. The police there tracking down a suspect who was seen walking into the campus in the middle of the night. CNN's Sarah Seidner has more.
Taylor Dumpson.
At 21, Taylor Dumpson is an American first. The first black woman to be elected student government president at the American University in Washington, D.C.
I fell to the floor and it was so emotional.
That euphoric feeling crushed just a day after she took office when these showed up on campus. Bananas hung with nooses scrawled with the name of a gorilla and the letters of the historically black sorority Dumpson belongs to.
First, as a student, I'm hurt. As a member of the organization, I'm appalled. But as the target of a hate crime, I'm numb.
The threats only grew. Suddenly, a known neo-Nazi group began targeting her online.
The guy behind it called for a choreographed campaign to intimidate and terrorize the head of the student body. We've seen white supremacists try to recruit on college campuses for years. But what's different today is there has been a velocity and a volume of these efforts that we've really never seen before.
The ADL blames groups like American Vanguard, Identity Europa, and American Renaissance for stirring racist sentiments on campus.
First of all, I completely reject the term white supremacy. I simply want the opportunity for my people, people of European origin, to be left alone so that we can pursue our own destiny.
We met up with Jared Taylor, the head of American Renaissance.
Do you think recruitment is going well?
Yes.
When it comes to young people?
I am constantly impressed by the number of young people who are completely wide awake on the subject of race, who are not bamboozled and intimidated by all of this nonsense of diversity being our strength.
Taylor says he wants to live in an all-white world separate from other races.
Are you racist?
I'm not racist. Whatever racist means, it is a pejorative term that means whatever you think is somehow immoral or wrong. I reject that idea completely.
Well, I think it's wrong that you think that someone like me is less intelligent just by my very nature of being black or brown.
Oh, come on. You are an individual. You may be smarter than most white people on earth.
I know, but overall, you're saying that my race is less intelligent than yours.
And my race, on average, is less intelligent than Asians. Is that a hateful thing to say? It's where the science leads me, and I have to follow the data. I have no choice.
It's junk science. Just not believable.
What Taylor seems to fear the most, the day people of color outnumber whites in America.
If whites do nothing, they will be reduced to a minority in which their culture is a sideshow and which they themselves will be considered a despised group who did everything bad that all other groups suffer from.
So you experience what I've experienced or what people of my race have experienced.
I doubt you personally have much experience that.
You'd be surprised.
But he says no one, including the American University student, should be targeted with violence or harassment.
I consider it very rude. I wouldn't condone that kind of activity, but it's obviously not a crime.
As for Dumpson, now as president, she has a message to send. In her America, hate won't win.
I think back to the Maya Angelou poem, you know, still I rise. You know, just like dust, still I rise.
Sarah Seidner, CNN, Washington, D.C.
Our thanks to Sarah Seidner. Now, President Trump spoke to the Muslim world today. But many remember his harsh rhetoric about what he terms radical Islam that in part fueled his run to the White House. Coming up, W. Kamau Bell joins us live with an inside look at what it's like to be Muslim in small town America.
There's not actually a Muslim community. Like, in case the fact that there isn't peace in the Middle East is any indication, not all of us like each other.
This is not a battle between different faiths, different sects, or different civilizations. This is a battle between barbaric criminals who seek to obliterate human life and decent people, all in the name of religion. People that want to protect life and want to protect their religion. This is a battle between good and evil.
President Trump, the man who rode into office on a proposed Muslim ban and once declared Islam hates us, offering a new message to leaders of the Arab world in Saudi Arabia. Now back in the U.S., W. Kamau Bell discovered many Muslims in America calling Michigan home. The town of Dearborn boasts the largest mosque in North America. Nearby Hamtramck is home to the first majority Muslim city council in America. Here's a sneak peek at what Kamau discovered about life for those Muslims.
Tell me why Islam is weirder than Christianity again.
Muslims do have to face northeast towards Mecca, a daily reminder that we're all one. The point of the prayers is to keep that connection going. To give you a sample, this is what we will be reciting tonight. That's the translation.
This is the translation, because for a second I thought, oh my gosh, I can read Arabic, but it's working already.
Before a formal prayer, there's a traditional cleanse. And you can tell I was committed, because I don't just wet my afro for anybody.
W. Kamau Bell is joining me now. I like the end of that clip there. It makes us all want more. Before we talk about Muslims in America, let's talk just a little bit about the country that is home to Mecca. President Trump, his speech this morning in Saudi Arabia on Islam. You said you'd be watching closely. What did you make of the president's speech today?
I mean, you know, a lot is being made about how he sounded more reasonable than he had sounded before, but I think that's a pretty low bar compared to where he came from. You know, he said that Islam hates us, and is, you know, we talk about the episode, the Muslim ban of the 7 and 6 countries. So I think that, like, if anything, he should have gone there to apologize if he was really trying to reset things, but he tried to sort of act like this is what he'd been saying all along.
Do you think what he said today would resonate with the folks you spoke to in tonight's episode?
I mean, I think the folks that I spoke to in tonight's episode have a very long view of this whole thing and aren't, and as much as they have to focus on what the president is doing as far as the laws of this country and how it affects them and their people who live in these other countries, there was a sense of hope among people that I was really sort of blown away by. Like, you know, he showed the scene that you just saw me at the mosque, and I think that they're watching it very closely, but I can't imagine they have a lot of trust in that speech or felt as good about it as many in the media seem to feel about it.
Were many of those people worried or afraid, given just the current climate in America when it comes to terrorism or the attitude toward some people toward Muslims?
I mean, I think that a lot of this is about, like, trying to, again, they want to sort of change the narrative to where it should be at. Most, it's what we would call extremist terrorism, affects people who are Muslims or Arabs. So they're thinking about that already. And I think that what they're trying to say is, like, I think that the big thing comes out of tonight's episode is, like, there's not just one version of Islam or one typical Muslim. It's the biggest religion in the world. I mean, I think the thing we're trying to do is, like, there's a diversity of opinion in the episode, which should help us when we talk about Islam. We don't think of it as one thing, as one type of person who has one type of belief in their religion.
Did they have any thoughts about what the solution is in terms of combating extremism?
I mean, I feel like if they were interested, I would sort of start a service taking bus trips of people to Hamtramck and Dearborn, just so you could say, whatever you think you're scared about, look at this very sleepy suburb with the delicious food. Whatever you think is going to happen if you see women walking down the street in hijabs and burqas is not happening here. It's just people trying to live their lives and get their part of the American dream. I feel like if the CNN show gets canceled, that's the service I will start if the people of Dearborn and Hamtramck are into it. Because I feel like it's just about seeing people up close, and we shouldn't always have to do that, but I feel like we have to do that.
Well, you're bringing us there. I mean, that's what is so great about your show. You spent some time with millennials, millennial Muslims, and you talked with them about how they remain true to their faith in the modern era, and so many young people of other religions are falling away from their faiths right now. What keeps them motivated?
Yeah, I mean, I was really compelled by them because they didn't sound like they were changing the religion to fit them, other than having an app on their phones that gave them the call to prayer, which is pretty cool. But they really believe in their religion on a very deep and fundamental level. While at the same time, if they walk past you in the street, they look like any other millennial you'll see. And I think that, like, in this time where people are searching for meaning, they feel like they have that meaning in their religion. So it was pretty inspiring. I felt like I need to go to church after I talked to them. I didn't go to church, but I should.
Oh, you just ratted yourself out. Thank you, W. Kamau Bell. We look forward to your episode tonight. You can catch his brand new episode of United Shades of America tonight at 10 p.m. Eastern right here on CNN. Well, the vice president getting an icy reception as he prepared to address students at the University of Notre Dame in the commencement ceremony today. Some graduates simply stood up for what they say is religious freedom for all. They walked out on his commencement address. CNN's Rosa Flores was there. Rosa?
Now, the students who stood up and walked out of their commencement ceremony said it best. They said that this is their graduation day, and they graduated from a Catholic university. And on this campus, they learned about religious freedom for all, not just for Christians, but also for their Muslim brothers and sisters. They also say that they learned about standing up for the marginalized, for the poor, for the LGBTQ community. And they say that these teachings are straight from Pope Francis, and they don't believe that Vice President Mike Pence represents those teachings.
Either we are all Notre Dame or none of us are. And if you are trying to silence and not listen to the preferences of one group and their families, then you're not listening to any of us. And that was a speech, or I guess that was what we wanted to say today to the administration, more so than anyone else. The administration, you need to listen to our peers. You need to listen to our peers' families and concerns when you decide who to invite to our graduation.
Some context is important here because about 3,100 students received degrees, and between 75 and 100 students stood up and walked out once Vice President Mike Pence began to speak. Ana.
Rosa Flores, our thanks to you. Thanks for rolling into the 8 o'clock hour.